to welcome to class. This class is Handling Hot Life Arena Topics in a Hot-Headed Culture. And I find it very ironic that this was supposed to be the class last week on hot topics and God canceled it with ice. You just can't stop God.
And he's got a sense of humor.
And it's warm outside. It's just all perfectly orchestrated, right?
Yes.
So I want to pray in a minute. I want to put a little context on the prayer because today a lot of churches around the country, maybe around the world, but especially in America, are celebrating the beauty of human life, sanctity of human life, and doing that in various ways. Our church is doing a number of different things today, but I also realize that can be a very hard day for a lot of people. People who have something in their personal story that they haven't dealt with, maybe, and you can feel condemned or guilty or shamed or whatever. And so, and others just need encouragement. I remember, I don't know, it was like 12, 13 years ago, we were preparing for this Sunday here at Twin Oaks when I was a staff pastor here, and we were going to do a live ultrasound and on somebody. And while this was happening, during worship service, they're going to project the ultrasound on a screen, and Rodney Storch was going to read scriptures that affirm life. Does anybody remember this?
Oh, yes. Yes.
So we show up at church that morning, and the screen from the ceiling had fallen out of the ceiling and was laying on the platform. So the deacons rigged extension cords on the screen and like hauled it up back up to the ceiling, and everything went fine. But you know, the devil does not like church in general, but he particularly hates sanctity of life because he came to kill, steal, and destroy. And when you talk about issues of sanctity of life, you're really getting into his wheelhouse. So let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you so much that you are the author of life, the giver of life, the lover of life. You are the life, the way, the truth, and the life. And we celebrate that today, God. We celebrate you. And we give our hearts to you today and ask you to mold and shape us. Lord, whether it's encouragement or conviction or comfort or wisdom that we need, give us everything we need, Lord, to know, enjoy you, and serve you in this difficult area. Pray especially for men and women who might come to church here or other churches today who are carrying with them a darkness, something unconfessed, something undealt with, something difficult. And they may be hearing things today in church that prick or open the door to that area of darkness. I pray, Lord, that you would flood that darkness with your glorious and redemptive grace and mercy in the gospel. That today will be a day of release for those folks, experience of your goodness and forgiveness. And for others, I pray that, especially in this class, that you'd give us wisdom and help us to see and enjoy your gospel and see how it applies to responding to hot topics, difficult topics. So we give ourselves to you, and we're very happy you're here. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so this class is, here's the billing for this class. This is the purpose of the class. We're radiating with gospel. Now, how many of you were here 2 weeks ago? Okay, so most of you. So when I say radiating with gospel astonishment, can somebody venture to explain to me what these mean from last time we were together? You want to give it a shot? You don't have to be perfect at it, but what is this? Anybody want to try?
Seeing the world through the gospel, through the word of God,
through
the cross of salvation.
Right, right. So Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, "Therefore, brothers, I urge you, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as living sacrifices." So Paul in Romans is saying, I want you to put on your gospel glasses and leave them on, and it changes how we see everything. It changes how we see our wallet, it changes how we see our neighbor, it changes how we see ourselves, it changes how we see our enemies, it changes how we see an abortionist, a woman in crisis pregnancy, an older adult, someone with special needs, our president, or anybody. It changes everything. So that's what we mean still radiating with gospel astonishment. I hope that you guys have been wearing your gospel glasses. Like I said, you can go to Walmart and get some cheap glasses. And this is just masking tape. So you can, fun project with your kids, by the way, or your grandchildren. Romans 12, 1, talk about the verse and have everybody make their own little gospel glasses, right? All right, so still radiating with gospel astonishment, we'll explore ways to love our neighbors, coworkers, fellow students, and others regarding fiery hot life arena topics like LGBTQ, local school policies, abortion, and more. And there are plenty of those. Excuse me. So this is a class that enjoys interaction. At least I enjoy interaction. So I'll be asking some questions, so hopefully you guys can just chew on that, and we'll interact a little bit as we try to work on some of this stuff. So let me ask you first, right off the bat, what qualifies something as a hot topic? I mean, there's a lot of topics. You know, the color of the carpet is a topic. You know, what kind of tie do you put on this morning? That's a topic. But what's a hot topic? What does it take for a topic to be a hot topic? Just what do you think? What are your thoughts about that?
Controversial.
Yeah.
Controversial, okay?
Life-affecting.
Life-affecting, good. Yeah.
Strong emotional response.
Emotional response, yes, good.
Protesters.
Protesters, okay. So that's almost a summary of passion, affects life, that's an expression, good.
Disagreement.
Disagreement, controversy, yeah. Yeah, good. Anything else?
Personal.
Personal, yeah, so that's interesting too, because a lot of things we just said could be construed as kind of issues out there. I mean, there are hot topics out there, but when a topic is really hot, it has personal impact, right? So that's pretty good. I mean, you guys, these are the things I thought about, and you hit them all. So personal heat, you know, has some effect on you and me. Susan?
I would also say biblical, because occasionally I'll mention something and a person will say, oh, well, that's, you know, political. Well, while it might also be political, it's
good.
If it's the life issue, it's biblical.
Very good. In fact, just wait 1 second and we'll hit that one. Public heat was mentioned, right? It affects culture, controversy. It's protest is a public thing. So there's a public aspect to it. This is partly what you were mentioning. There's divine heat. It's something, I mean, God's interested in all things, including what color your socks are. I mean, he really is, believe it or not. So don't be thinking about the color of your socks now. Just keep going with me. But things where God in his word, where he said, this is something at the core of my heart, something that really affects me, something that agitates me or that I'm interested in, right? So personal heat, public heat, divine heat, and expressed in a number of ways. Can you think of some examples of hot topics? Just that meet these kinds of qualifications, especially life issues. I mean, it doesn't have to be just life issues, but what kinds of hot topics qualify for this?
Abortion,
yeah, basically, yes.
Redefining marriage.
Yes, redefining marriage in general, good.
The election.
The election, yeah, that's kind of a hot topic. Yeah. Still hot topic, right? What else?
The act of end of life with dignity.
End of life with dignity, yeah. Things like physician-assisted suicide is kind of flared up and come down, up and down. Good. Anything else? Hot topics?
Freedom to worship as we choose and not being forced to bake cakes for things we don't believe in.
Okay. All right, so there's a lot of things in what you said. The role of government in the lives of organizations and individuals. The freedoms, the Constitution, convictions, how to live them out. Good. Yes, Jim?
When you get down to it, isn't it really a matter of doing life God's way versus doing life any other way, whether it's doctrines of demons or human things we think up? But it's really gets down to God's way versus any other way.
Yeah, I think that's probably fair. Yeah. The million-dollar question is, okay, how do we unpack that?
Yeah.
That's a very clear, maybe simple, maybe accurate summary. But this class, for example, is about how do we unpack that? Like, how do we actually live that out? So that's a good example. I did a little research. This is just life issues. When we talk about life issues, one of the things your life team wants to do through this Sunday school series, which continues through May, is to help our church really understand that the life team and a gospel-believing church is not just, you know, against abortion, even though we are. There are many other topics that are ethically very similar. And also there are other issues around the actual act of abortion which are very significant. For example, upstream from abortion, you have crisis pregnancy and providing counsel and help and resources. And after maybe giving birth, they decide to keep, you have adoption and foster care and parenting and all these things. So when we think about life arena topics, we don't want to just think about the topic of abortion, even though that is a topic. So here's just a few things, and these are, I'm listing these because they meet those criteria, especially because they captivated national headlines for at least several weeks, if not months, if not over a year. So see if you remember any of these things. So Supreme Court decision in June of 2015, mm-hmm. Legalizing same-sex marriage just captivated the headlines. Planned Parenthood, the baby part thing, mm-hmm. y'all remember that? That captivated the headlines. The undercover, the undercover videos, and what are we going to do about that? And it became a big issue on the presidential debates. It came up. California's a physician-assisted suicide law. It was passed into law in October. That became an issue. They're the fifth state to legalize this. After that, Brittany Maynard, who's 29, diagnosed with cancer, became a national story where she decided to move to Oregon, where physician-assisted suicide is legal, so that she could legally have someone kill her. That, through physician-assisted suicide, that became a big deal. You know, like a Terri Schiavo thing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right. You remember Terri Schiavo. Yes. That's beyond 2015, but that was a big issue. Yes. What do we do? That's life. That's life issue. Syrian refugee crisis. How do we treat image bearers of God? Especially when they're vulnerable. How do we do that? And there's a lot of debate about that. And there remains a lot of debate about that. The shooting at Planned Parenthood in Colorado, I don't know if you remember that. But big shooting out there. U.S. presidential elections. And a lot of the issues related to the elections may not be what you consider things like hot topics in this realm. Just ideas like national defense is in some way related, because you're thinking, how do we defend life? How do we protect life? How do we do it in ways that are ethical and so on? And yesterday, all over the country and in Washington, protesters and marchers in Washington, and I watched some of the interviews, and it seemed like in Washington at least, a lot of the protesters were there for maybe only a few reasons. If you ask someone on the street in the protest, in the march, why are you here, why are you doing this, there may be a few reasons, and one of those was abortion rights.
Right.
And we're afraid that those rights are being threatened, and so we're out here marching. So, hot topic. Hot enough to get hundreds of thousands of people out across the country. So, that's what we're dealing with. So the question we have in front of us today is, how in the world do we handle this stuff? Like, how do we respond? But as I've talked about this topic before, I've realized that actually have to start with the question, should we even talk about it? Because in my line of work, what I do in serving churches around the country and pastors and so on, what I find that's the first question is, is this even the role of the church? Forget about what we should say. In other words, the question is, should we even say something? And so we have to start there. So, before we go there, what I've found in churches, including this church, is there's a spectrum of answering the question, should I talk about hot topics or should I not talk about hot topics? There's a spectrum. And I want you to think about this church as I talk about the spectrum, and maybe other churches you've visited or been part of. And these are two extremes. One extreme among church leaders is we always talk about hot topics. Hot topics drive the preaching and teaching content. They drive it. So any given Sunday, you know, we kind of look at what's going on in the culture and in the world, and we preach the Bible relevant to that topic. Okay? That's one extreme. The other extreme is over here, which is the, we're just preaching the Bible. We're going through the book of John. It doesn't matter if the trade towers fall. It doesn't matter. None of those topics matter. This Sunday, we're in chapter 5, verse 15, and we're going to preach on John chapter 5, verse 15. Period. We're not going to let the tail wag the dog, as it were. The culture wag the dog. So, see those two extremes? So, honesty 101. Where do you think Twin Oaks falls on that spectrum? We're family. We're family. Right? What do you think? And, you know.
In the middle.
You think we're in the middle?
No.
No?
No.
All right, we're going to have a fight right here in Sunday school. Good. We have an in the middle.
More to the Bible.
More to the Bible side.
Yeah. This is our schedule. Let's keep on trucking.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
good.
My opinion.
All right. Sounds like kind of a consensus, roughly. I would tend to agree with that. What would you think about a church, and I don't remember back what Twin Oaks did on this day. What would you think of a church, for example, on 9/11, that the Sunday after 9/11 didn't talk about 9/11 in worship? Do you think that's appropriate?
No.
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 We need to comfort and encourage.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm just trying to get us thinking about this. I want you to think about your kitchen table conversations in your own homes, and how often you talk about these topics, especially from a biblical perspective. I mean, anybody can sit down over a cup of coffee and talk about their opinion, but I mean opening the Bible and talking about it. Or in your small groups, flocks. I don't think they call them flocks anymore, do they?
Yes.
They do?
Yes.
Folds or, okay. That's a hot topic. Should we call them flocks or not call them flocks? What does flocks mean anyway? All right. So do our flocks talk about these things? And, you know, I'm just thinking, think about it. In other places of our Christian lives, do we talk about these things? One thing's for sure, the culture is definitely talking about these things. So it's not like, if we don't talk about them at all, it's not like nobody's talking about them. In fact, in a lot of these things, everybody's talking about them, and the church, at times, is the only one not talking about them.
Wait a second, though. But some of these situations, you have people that are pursuing certain agenda.
Right.
And any particular, you probably heard the term, don't let a crisis go to waste.
Mm-hmm.
So either something happens and they push their agenda, or even worse, they manipulate so that a crisis happens so that the agenda can be pushed. There are those who are very adept at that sort of thing, whereas we in the quote-unquote church, we're not usually out there trying to manipulate big events so that we can push an agenda.
Yeah, so what Jim brings up is, you're moving still into the question of how do we do it?
No, we're still into should we, because there's also the verse, I mean, you quoted this one about being the salt, but there's also the verse, and I'm sorry, I can't quote chapter and verse, that talks about don't resist evil. And I'm like, okay, where are we in that spectrum about what do we do?
Well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about it. And I do have this verse. In fact, there's a handout. If you don't have a handout, Carrie, can somebody give people the handout if you don't have one? There's over here. I did put this verse up here as a starting place for us. So, in fact, Jim, will you read this verse for us out loud with your nice booming voice?
Thank you.
And then we'll talk about it a little bit.
You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven.
All right, thanks very much. So, this is in the Sermon on the Mount. Who's Jesus talking to here? Who's the audience, you recall?
Disciples.
Believers.
Sure.
Yeah. Believers, yeah.
At least you could say followers of Jesus. And they're probably, a lot of them are like us. They're mediocre, lukewarm, up and down, on and off, hot and cold people, just like us.
Right.
So he's teaching them, and this is right after the Beatitudes. And so he's addressing something here that's extremely relevant to our conversation today. Let me just ask a couple of questions. First of all, what's the difference between Jesus saying, you are, and the salt of the earth? What's the difference between saying you are the salt of the earth and him saying, I wish you would act like the salt of the earth? What's the difference between those two statements?
Between an indicative and an imperative.
Oh, my. Everybody here is a seminary person. Will you please explain for us, humble?
Sure. An indicative is a statement of fact, and an imperative is a command. So you are is saying, it's just declaring what is. It's not telling you to become something that you're not already.
Awesome. Did you all hear that?
Yes.
So yes, very good. He's not saying, I want you to work hard, and then you'll eventually become this. He's making a statement of fact. He's declaring identity. Like, you are salt. You are light. You are those things. And that changes how we approach this question of how we live in the world and address hot topics. Because some of us, sometimes in this world, in this conversation, people will think it is optional to do things or say things about hot topics. And you have to grapple with identity statements like this, that actually you are, this is the very nature and constitution of what you're like.
Right.
So we'll talk about, you have in your handout, I think, the text printed, but a couple of questions. That's identity. You are, and I always want to say Penn State after that, because it's, we are Penn State anyway. That's where I went to school. Salt reverses rottenness, right? It preserves, it enhances flavor. They didn't have ice, really, in Israel back then, so they didn't use salt like we use salt to melt ice, but reversing rottenness is a big one, preserve things. And light dispels darkness and illumines. A lamp, right? If it's a dark room, you bring a lamp into the dark room, all the darkness flies away. It dispels darkness. So this is our basic constitution. So, for example, wherever you and I see rottenness, when we walk into the room, here's the rottenness reversing power of God. Just walked into the room. And wherever there's darkness, it's in your school, your workplace, your family, your neighborhood, wherever there's darkness, when you walk into the room or into the conversation, here comes something that's going to can dispel darkness. Here comes a light. It still doesn't get at how do we do it. Right? This is just a declaration of identity. So no Christian can sit here and say, well, we don't have any role. There's a lot more to talk about, but no Christian can actually sit and say, we have no role to reverse rottenness and dispel darkness. That's not the job of a Christian. That's not part of our identity. You'd have to grapple with this passage in that case. You see what I'm saying? All right. So that's a starting place. So then there's an indictment against, really this is a scathing passage, actually at its heart. Jesus says, if you don't live out your saltiness, you've lost your taste. And he uses a Greek word there called moreno, or moriano, from which we get the English word. What do you think, what English word do you think we get from moriano?
Moraine.
If you act like an idiot.
Moron.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, Bugs Bunny calls it maroon, but go ahead.
So just think about that. Here's Jesus, you know, meek and mild, right, supposedly. He's telling his people, if I'm calling you salt, and if you don't live as salt, you're morons. You're acting moronically. It would have been just as insulting then as it is today. All right? So Jesus, in his typical fashion, is starting to amp things up. He's turning up the heat. Then he says, kryptos, a light can't be hidden. And the word for hidden is kryptos. What English word do you think we get from kryptos? Not kryptonite, no.
Right.
You do this every time you enter a password for your online banking. This is what happens.
Encryption.
Encryption. Think about the word encryption. N means in Greek, N, in. Crypt, or crypt. What's a crypt? It's a place for dead people. So when you and I don't live as light, we are encrypting Jesus and ourselves. That is an insult. Jesus is insulting and ratcheting up the power of this text. All right? I can just tell you from personal experience, and of course I can be a self-righteous jerk sometimes, and hopefully I push back on that with the gospel, but sometimes it really bothers me when I see preachers who are afraid.
Yeah.
Now, I get afraid too, and you get afraid too. We all get afraid. So you see where I said I can be a self-righteous jerk and a hypocrite? I know I'm not the only one in the room. So the idea of a preacher or any Christian not speaking clearly about things that are relevant, there can be an element of encryptos. All right, so, and this was an example I just found on the internet. You probably can't read it, but it's an encrypted password. So you look at it, you have no idea what the actual password is. And this is what a lot of Christians look like. We're encrypted.
Yeah.
We walk around in a world because we're afraid or whatever it is, and there's hot topics. We're at the copy machine at work. We're at the PTA meeting. A hot topic comes up, and we just all of a sudden embed all this code around ourselves so no one can know exactly what maybe Jesus or God thinks about that topic. We still haven't talked about how you do enter that conversation. We're just getting at foundational things. And then there's some warnings. So Jesus ratchets up the heat more. He says, if you are Moreno or Moriano, if you're acting like a moron, you're good, no longer good for anything. I mean, what? That is not the Jesus of my Sunday school flannel graph, who's always smiling. That's pretty rough, right? Then he says you'll eventually be thrown out, and that's where you come into the Greek text and you find a divine passive. A divine passive, it's a form of a verb in Greek. And what it means is when the actor is not, the person doing the action is not specified, it's almost always God. So what that means when God says in this passage, you'll be thrown out, and he doesn't specify the actor, it means that God will throw you out. That's pretty serious. And what happens when you get thrown out? Trampled underfoot by men. I am so glad I did not write this text. This text is razor sharp, two-edged, hot text. It just amps up the sobriety of what we're talking about today. Like, it's not an option for us not to say anything. That's just not an option. Again, the question we haven't talked about is, how do you say what you say? How do you do what you do? So just even right now, hopefully some of us are squirming and thinking about the places in our lives where we face very difficult topics and issues, and we're starting to realize, you know what? I think I've been encrypting myself. I think I've been acting like a moron. At the condo association meeting, I should have said something. At the work, at the staff meeting, I should have said something. At the school board meeting, I should have said something. With my family, I should have said something. With my daughter, who got pregnant, and she's a teenager, I should have said something. So I started to think about those things. Yes?
To go back what Jim said before, and we're talking about should, there's a lot of hot topics, and sometimes hot topics are thrown out there to draw the church in, to, you know, maybe put them in a bad light, or to, you know, to get them into something that's a question mark whether you should get into it. So the question comes, I guess, is that every hot topic that's out there, should the church be involved with it, or how do you discern which hot topics you get involved with?
That is a great question, Dave. I'm not going to answer that question. We'll talk about, though, kind of the underlying questions in that. Like, how do we choose? How do we discern?
Right.
And we also will talk about the fears that we sometimes face that our church or us as individuals will be cast in a bad light if we say something. We're going to deal with that a little bit, too. All right. Yeah, Jim.
Also, related to this issue of identity versus a command, there's a situation where for a okay, I was military. So a general goes along, and Jesus is far higher than any general, where the general speaks a statement, that becomes a command. For instance, I was on a base once where I looked around and all the guy wires that came off of utility poles weren't yellow, as you expect, they were all brown. The posts for street signs were all brown. I thought, what's going on? And I asked somebody, he said, well, the general was driving along, he said, be nice if everything was earth colors around here. The folks rightly took that as a command. So if Jesus is here saying you are, I'm going to treat that as a command from our commander.
Okay, I mean, well, fine. Take it however you want. I'm telling you it's an indicative.
It wasn't a suggestion.
Yeah, I get it was a comment. So this statement of identity obviously bleeds over into you are what you do, or you do what you are kind of thing. Jesus expects us to live out our identity.
Right.
He doesn't just say, you're salt, so just sit there as salt. Yeah. The whole text is about, here's who you are, and here's what it looks like to live like you are. So, a couple more things about the should and the how. God's record in redemptive history. Does God address hot topics throughout the Bible?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, good answer. Jesus' incarnate ministry, did Jesus address hot topics?
Yes.
Now, I mean, you may be thinking, well, golly, you know, what hot topics did Jesus address? Can you think of any hot topics, besides salvation and eternal life, and those are the hottest of hot topics, but can you think of political topics? Can you think of controversial topics beside those things that Jesus addressed?
Hey, Caesar, what is Caesar?
So taxes, yeah, render unto Caesar what is Caesar. People showed him the coin.
Healing on the Sabbath.
Yeah, the Sabbath.
Healing on the Sabbath, good. What should, and we, okay, anything else?
Marriage,
yes. Divorce, yes.
Forgiveness of sin, we call the woman adultery.
Adultery, yes. Okay, so we can keep going, but Jesus did address these things. All right. Your personal history and salvation. You know, I wish we had time to just go around the room and share your personal story, how Jesus may have addressed hot topics in your life in bringing you to Christ. You know, he put his finger on something hot in your life. Maybe you're living in a way that was destructive to yourself and other people, and he just said, oh, I'm just going to shine some light on that rottenness, that darkness. I'm going to address that hot topic, Doug, in your life. And that was maybe part of the journey of him bringing you to himself. But God continues to do that, doesn't he? At least, I hope so. We'll talk about in a minute what it looks like in your and my life as far as our relationship with Jesus and how he does or doesn't address hot topics in our life. Because that has a massive effect on if and how we might address hot topics with other people. Okay? All right, so let's get into the how. And this is probably not going to be what you expected, which is fine, but hopefully better. I want to talk about two aspects of the how. Whenever you come to a class like this, a lot of people are just wanting, well, give me five practical tips. What to say, what not to say. And there's a place for that, for sure. But Jesus, always interested in getting at the heart first. Because he says, if you get the heart, you get the mouth thrown in, right? So we're going to talk a little bit about the heart. So the how for the mouth, we'll talk about that second. We're going to start with how as far as the heart. How do we orient our hearts? How do we see our hearts transformed so that there's a natural gush of appropriate, salty, and bright words coming out of our mouths in the right ways? So this is a verse I used last week, right? Let's see. Dave, could you read this for us, please?
The good person out of the good treasure of his heart produces good, and the evil person out of the evil treasures produces evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks.
Thanks a lot. So you see what's happening here? This is how all human beings are designed, Christian or non-Christian. Whatever's in your heart will come out of your mouth in one way or the other, right? And when it comes to hot topics are even if we try to have control over our lips, you know, there's like stuff is pushing up. Blah, you know, it's just hot topics have a tendency to do that. Does anybody remember what I did with this last time? Does anybody want to try to explain?
We haven't cleaned it up from the last time.
If you will notice, Mr. Scheibe, there is no stain.
It's just mixed in with the other ones, right?
That's right. This pristine carpeting we have. All right, so I had said, as an illustration, this is you and me, right? And what's inside is what's in our hearts. And so if I put water in the bottle and I tip it over, squeeze it, what comes out?
Water.
Are you sure? It's pretty weak, people. All right, if I put grape juice in there, what comes out if I tip it?
Grape juice.
Right. Motor oil?
Motor oil.
All right, good. So what if I put gold leaf, actual 24 karat gold leaf on this bottle, and I hot glue real diamonds and rubies and emeralds on it, and there's motor oil inside, and I squeeze it or tip it over, what comes out?
Motor oil.
Right. So the idea is that whatever's inside will come out somehow.
Right.
And you remember what I said about hot topics and actually life issues? Right?
Squeeze them.
That's what it's like. You know this, right? It's only water. Everybody relax. Don't report me to the session. Or to church discipline. You guys know. You know, in heated conversations, try as you might, that's what happens in your life, isn't it? You say things that are in your heart that you wish you could take back. And so again, that's just an illustration from extremity of the principle of what Jesus is talking about. Jesus, God, is constantly kind of coming after the human heart. He's always wanting the heart. So we're going to talk about the heart. Here's what I drew last time. The inner being, which is your affections, your will, your emotions, what's going on in your internal landscape, it moves outward. It moves outward. So I had said, I think last time, I had at one point when I was a staff pastor here, a young man came to me, addicted to pornography, and he sat in my office, and you know, you should sue me for malpractice if I sat with that young man and I said, hey, here's your answer, and I pulled out a special pair of sunglasses. I said, just put these sunglasses on every day, even if they're gospel sunglasses. Just put these glasses on every day and it'll solve your problem. That would be irresponsible because the problem is in the heart. There's a longing and a craving in the heart that's working itself out. Or a person that has anger issues and they yell a lot, if I'm their pastor, it would be dumb of me to say, well, Mrs. Johnson, here's your answer, and I pull out a tube of cherry lip smackers. I say, you just put this on every morning, and it'll control your lips. It's a heart issue. It's our hearts. So I'm going to ask a couple of heart questions, and a lot of these are designed to kind of just get us to think, at least, about some of these things. So first of all, how's it going with Jesus? I asked this last time. What's your relationship like with him?